Hi there, welcome to the new video. Today I'll be talking about this paper, which is titled as Training Question Answering Models from Synthetic Data. This is from researchers from NVIDIA and Rice University. So let's start with the abstract. So they say, question and answer generation is a data augmentation method that aims to improve question answering models given the limited amount of human label data. So yeah, this is pretty true for most of the realistic use cases, because let's say if you're trying to build question answering system of some custom domain, let's say of technical reports and repositories, then in those cases, it's really hard to have a large scale human annotated data set where you're given the context, somebody would read in the question and then they would highlight like what is the answer that kind of corresponds to this question and for this context. So one of the large scale data sets that's available right now for doing this question answering task is called Squad. So one of the ideal ways is like you first train your system on Squad data set and then try to fine tune it for your own data set. But that again poses a kind of a problem, because the kind of answers, the language, the vocabulary, all of that distribution is a little different to how it would have been if you have had a larger training data set for the custom domain itself. So that way the model might not be able to generalize well. So in this paper, the authors claim that you do not need a lot of realistic examples. Rather, if you use a couple of realistic examples to generate a lot of synthetic examples, you are good to go and you will reach comparable performance. Also, in some case, you might surpass the state-of-the-art models that were trained on large human-labeled question answering tasks. So yeah, that's the entire idea of the paper. So for generating these synthetic examples, authors propose a three-step pipeline. We'll talk about this as we proceed forward in the paper. So they also say, like, when they tested for Squad 1.1 question answering task, they achieved a higher accuracy solely with the synthetic questions that they had generated compared to Squad 1.1 training set questions alone that were human-labeled. So that's a pretty impressive result. So let's move forward and see all those three steps in the pipeline which you can use to generate these questions and answers. Okay, so here they mention that they want to generate a high quality training data set, just like Squad style, which is extractive in nature. So for this, they'll have to sample a triple of context, question and answer, where a context belongs to the document D. So the first step in the pipeline is called answer generation, that would generate a sample answer for a given context. So yeah, this is independent of question, which is unlike to how typical question answering models are trained. So the idea here is to just learn the distribution of answers, how they usually occur, in what pattern, in what context. So that's where we just given the context and sample all the possible answers that are possible for that context. The second step in the pipeline is question generation, where again the idea is, let's say if I give you the context and let's say the answer that I have generated as a part of previous step, what are the possible questions that I might ask to get that same answer? And the final step in the pipeline is called round trip filtration method. So the motivation over here is to overgenerate and then filter things. So for example, I'll give in the context, I'll give in the questions that I've generated, and I'll try to sample the answers. So now this is typical to how question answering system works, where you're given the context and the question, and then you give in the highlighted section, which is the extractive segment from the answer. So now over here, if the extracted segment that the model returns is similar to what I have generated earlier as the part of first step, which means the question that I'm asking is correct for that answer, and hence that question becomes valid, else we reject that question. So yeah, this is the basic idea to how this pipeline entirely works. So let's see the algorithm. So the first step in the algorithm is to kind of sample the answer candidates from paragraphs using the BERT model. So which is again similar to learning P of A given a context C, which belongs to a paragraph. So once you get many answers, let's say over here, the next step is to generate questions from these answer candidates and paragraphs using the GPT-2 model that basically learns to output a next token considering whatever it has generated in the past. So as a part of this step, they are learning the probability of generating a question Q given the answer that I have sampled. Let's call this set as A hat. So I'll give this A hat and the context C, and this way I'll generate some of the questions. Let's call this Q hat. So now I have a set of questions and set of answers. The next thing is to check which of the questions are valid. So that is where the round trip consistency model comes into the play, which is again a BERT transformer, over which they essentially try to learn a function that knows the probability of generating an answer A given some context and the questions that I have generated. So now the answer that it generates matches one of the answers over here, then this question is treated to be valid. If that's not the case, then we reject this question and move to the second question. So yeah, this way, following this first, second and third step, you'll get a triple of context, question and answers, which is again the expected output what you would have gotten if a human would have labeled the dataset. Now the task is pretty clear. you train the BERT question answering model on this set and then evaluate it. So yeah, that's the entire algorithm. So if we see a little bit more detail into answer generation model, this is the mathematical representation of the same. So here they jointly model the start and end token spans. Unlike a typical flow where you learn start head separately and end head separately, here they use both of them at the same time to calculate the loss. So firstly, they would input the context into the BERT model, and then they would extract the head corresponding to the start and end token. They'll concatenate the embeddings of both the representation and then pass it through a multilayer perceptron unit. And at the output end, you'll get a softmax over all the possible spans that might have occurred. And the aim of the model is to kind of skew this distribution so that the actual span gets the value that's close to 1 and the rest of the spans kind of diminish to 0. So that's what you can see in this equation. You're concatenating the representation of the BERT start and end tokens. You pass it through the multilayer perceptron. Whatever the representation that you get, you plug that in the softmax function, and that is the probability that you want to maximize. Okay. So yeah, this is the entire flow of training and evaluating the question generation system that they have proposed. So you start with squad train dataset. You split it into two parts. You use the first half for training all these three components what we have. And once you have the trained model ready, you use the other half to generate the synthetic data. So mostly you'll be kind of sampling the context over here, because rest all of these models will take care of generating questions and answers. So at the synthetic data level, you'll have this triple of context, question and answer, which you use to train your BERT model. And once you have the trained question answering model on the synthetic data, you test it on the squad dev data. So yeah, in your case, if you can think of, if you have your tech reports or which you want to build your question answering system, replace squad train with that. But I think still you'll need to have some amount of labeled data. Consider that to be training half. Use that to train this model. Now use the unlabeled set that you already have, which is the larger chunk. Pass them through this trained model and get the synthetic data for that, and then follow this entire pipeline. But apart from this particular use case, you can also think of this step as the pre-training step like we usually have for any other task. For example, in the case of T5 and Pegasus, you have this extractive spans which you train against as a part of first step so that it learns the summarization or sequence generation problem effectively. Here, the idea is to pre-train the system with some question answering task, because that will be the ultimate task where we would apply our models. So yeah, this way this paper kind of addresses both of the problems. Okay. So now talking about the question generation system, which we have already discussed, is a pre-trained GPT-2 based model. So for training this system, what they do is, you have question tokens, then separator token, then you have answer token, then separator token, then question token, then separator token. You basically concatenate all these sequences into one large sequence, separating them with proper markers. And then you define segment embedding separately for all of these segments, as in this is for context, this is for answer, and this is for question. So this will help model to kind of bifurcate the type of inputs it is expecting, and will be able to differentiate between those things. And then you add the positional embeddings. Also in the context embeddings, they infuse this answer type embeddings so that the model gets the notion of position where this answer occurs in the larger paragraph. So yeah, once you have this larger sequence, let's call it as L, you pass this to transformer one step at a time with the language modeling loss, which means at any time t, you would predict what should be the t+1 token by just seeing all the words that you have generated. So yeah, this is the plain loss that they use. Also, yeah, I forgot to tell, they also infuse a special token, which is question and then colon. And they use this entire token before and after the question tokens, because that would kind of help during the inference cycle, wherein they just given the context and answer tokens along with this trigger token, and they would start sampling all the question tokens till the next occurrence of the same token is received. So yeah, that way you're kind of controlling a little bit of false generations. Okay, let's move forward. So the final step is round trip filtration, which we had already discussed, as in the aim for this step was to only keep questions that are valid and remove others. So for this, they again use the half split of the training data from squad and train a typical question answering model. And during inference, you would pass in the context, the questions generated as a part of previous step, and now what this model thinks for what should be the answer. If that matches the answer that we have already generated as a part of first step, then we consider this question to be valid. So yeah, I think we are done with the paper now. So yeah, it was a pretty interesting read to kind of learn a model from actual distribution and then use that to synthesize more dataset, and then just training the model on the synthetic data rather than a typical combination of both. So yeah, having said that, if you're still listening to me, which means you must have liked this video. So do not forget to hit that like button and subscribe to this channel. It'll definitely motivate me to make more videos like this. Also share it across with your friends to whosoever are interested in such content. I'll meet you in the next one. Bye-bye and take care.